Daddy Long Legs. Daddy Long Legs is an epistolary novel written by Jean Webster. It is the story of a girl named Jerusha Abbott who likes to call herself Judy. She lives in an orphanage which completely runs on charity. One of the trustees pays for Judy's education and also gives her a monthly allowance. However, he has a condition that Judy must write monthly letters to him, updating him on her performance. He feels Judy can be a good writer, and writing the monthly letters will help her develop her writing skills. Judy has never met her benefactor, but from a glimpse of his shadow, she knows he is a tall person with long legs. So, Judy fondly calls him Daddy Long Legs. Given below is a letter that Judy wrote to Daddy Long Legs. Dear Daddy Long Legs, is it snowing where you are?
All the world that I see from my tower is draped in white, and the flakes are coming down as big as popcorns.
It's late afternoon. The sun is just setting, a cold yellow color, behind some colder violet hills, and I am up in my window seat using the last light to write to you. Your 5 gold pieces were a surprise. I'm not used to receiving Christmas presents. You have already given me such lots of things. Everything I have, you know, that I don't quite feel that I deserve extras. But I like them just the same. Do you want to know what I bought with my money? 1. A silver watch in a leather case to wear on my wrist and get me to recitations in time. 2. Matthew Arnold's poems. 3. A hot water bottle. 4. A steamer rug.
My tower is cold.
5. 500 sheets of yellow manuscript paper. I'm going to commence being an author pretty soon. 6. A dictionary of synonyms to enlarge the author's vocabulary. 7. I don't much like to confess this last item, but I will. A pair of silk stockings. And now, Daddy, never say I don't tell all. It was a very low motive, if you must know it, that prompted the silk stockings. Julia Pendleton comes into my room to do geometry, and she sits cross-legged on the couch and wears silk stockings every night. But just wait, as soon as she gets back from vacation, I shall go in and sit on her couch in my silk stockings. You see, Daddy, the miserable creature that I am. But at least I'm honest. And you knew already from my orphanage record that I wasn't perfect, didn't you? To recapitulate, that's the way the English instructor begins every other sentence. I am very much obliged for my 7 presents. I'm pretending to myself that they came in a box from my family in California. The watches from my father, the rug from mother, the hot water bottle from grandmother, who is always worrying for fear I shall catch cold in this climate, and the yellow paper from my little brother Harry. My sister Isabel gave me the silk stockings. And Aunt Susan the Matthew Arnold poems. Uncle Harry, little Harry is named after him, gave me the dictionary. He wanted to send chocolates, but I insisted on synonyms. You don't object, do you, to playing the part of a composite family? And now, shall I tell you about my vacation? Or are you only interested in my education as such? I hope you appreciate the delicate shade of meaning in as such. It is the latest addition to my vocabulary. The girl from Texas is named Leonora Fenton. Almost as funny as Jerusha, isn't it? I like her, but not so much as Sally McBride. I shall never like anyone so much as Sally, except you. I must always like you the best of all, because you are my whole family rolled into one. Leonora and I and two sophomores have walked cross-country every pleasant day and explored the whole neighborhood. Dressed in short skirts and knit jackets and caps and carrying sticks to whack things with. Once we walked into town, 4 miles, and stopped at a restaurant where the college girls go for dinner. Broiled lobster, 35 cents, and for dessert, buckwheat cakes and maple syrup, 15 cents. Nourishing and cheap. It was such a lark, especially for me, because it was so awfully different from the orphanage.
I feel like an escaped convict every time I leave the campus.
Before I thought, I started to tell the others what an experience I was having. The cat was almost out of the bag when I grabbed it by its tail and pulled it back. It's awfully hard for me not to tell everything I know. I'm a very confiding soul by nature. If I didn't have you to tell things to, I'd burst. We had a molasses candy pull last Friday evening, given by the house matron of Ferguson to the left behinds in the other halls. There were 22 of us altogether, freshmen and sophomores and juniors and seniors, all united in amicable accord. The kitchen is huge, with copper pots and kettles hanging in rows on the stone wall. The littlest casserole among them, about the size of a wash boiler. 400 girls live in Ferguson. The chef, in a white cap and apron, fetched out 22 other white caps and aprons. I can't imagine where he got so many. And we all turned ourselves into cooks. It was great fun, though I have seen better candy. When it was finally finished, and ourselves and the kitchen and the doorknobs all thoroughly sticky, we organized a procession and, still in our caps and aprons, each carrying a big fork or spoon or frying pan, we marched through the empty corridors to the officers' parlor, where half a dozen professors and instructors were passing a tranquil evening. We serenaded them with college songs and offered refreshments.
They accepted politely, but dubiously.
We left them sucking chunks of molasses candy, sticky and speechless. So you see, Daddy, my education progresses. Don't you really think that I ought to be an artist instead of an author? Vacation will be over in 2 days, and I shall be glad to see the girls again.
My tower is just a trifle lonely.
when 9 people occupy a house that was built for 400, they do rattle around a bit. 11 pages. Poor daddy, you must be tired. I meant this to be just a short little thank you note. But when I get started, I seem to have a ready pen. Goodbye, and thank you for thinking of me. I should be perfectly happy, except for one little threatening cloud on the horizon. Examinations come in February. Yours with love, Judy.
P.S. Maybe it isn't proper to send love. If it isn't, please excuse. But I must love somebody. And there's only you and Mrs. Lippitt to choose between. So you see, you'll have to put up with it, Daddy dear. Because I can't love her. An extract from the novel Daddy Longlegs by Jean Webster.